Okay, go ahead and mute your mic. Hello. Welcome to the fifth session in the webinar series, Care of Diverse Elders and Their Families in Primary Care, sponsored by the Stanford Geriatric Education Center in collaboration with the California Area Health Education Centers, American Geriatric Society, and Natividad Medical Center. My name is Christopher Matola, and I will be your host for the session. We are very happy to have you join with us today as we present the program on Emergency Preparedness and Elder Care. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the chat feature on the screen to write your questions. The presenters will respond to the questions in the Q&A session at the end of their presentations. If you need to communicate with the presenters directly after the session, you may do so by sending an email to stanfordgec@stanford.edu. At conclusion of the webinar, please complete the short evaluation questionnaire. For those of you who have requested continuing education, I need to let you know that the webinar is not supported by any commercial Today's session will be presented by Dr. Charles A. Cefalu, Arleen Johnson, Elizabeth M. Shiels, Dr. McBride, Associate Director Emerita at FGEC, is involved in multidisciplinary geriatric and ethnogeriatric training programs offered through the internet. HRSA-funded geriatric education centers and other groups to disseminate information about geriatric emergency preparedness recoveries. Focus on chronic care, sensory rehabilitation, health, health promotion, and health literacy. Here is Melen. Make sure you turn on your microphone.
Good afternoon. Am I coming through okay? Am I coming through okay?
Yes, hello? Melen, you are. Yes, Melen, you're coming through fine.
Yes, sounds fine.
Hello, this is Melen McBride.
Hi, Melen.
Hello? Hello?
We hear you.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure. No one was responding. So good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our webinar, and thank you very much, Chris, for the introduction. I'd just like to take a very brief introduction on this webinar series. This is a result of the work that six geriatric education centers have formed to develop and create a collaborative. And we'll check if I have, okay. This began back in 2005, and we have six geriatric education centers that are, I'm sorry, it started in 2003, and the six geriatric education centers are listed here. And the next slide, excuse me, are some of the activities that we did in partnership with different professional organizations. We have a peer group session on preparedness with the American Geriatric Society. And we have assisted in creating a special interest group for disaster preparedness with the American Geriatric Society. And the peer group is with the American Society on Aging. And at some point, the group also had gone international by joining the Canada's Public Health Agency on Aging. And we continue to create partnerships. For the grant period of 2010 to 2011, this collaborative will work on several objectives and their own objectives. And these are just a sample of the objectives. The top one is to conduct one state regional training, and the Ohio Valley Appalachia Region GEC has conducted this, and you're going to be hearing about this in a few minutes. And these are all the others activities that you might hear about and perhaps participate in the future. And these are only just a sample of the objectives that the GIPR collaborative has for these 5 years. And our learning objectives for this webinar is to learn about urban and rural issues and all hazards, long-term care planning, and the different issues related to that. We will hear about the eight-state earthquake preparedness, and some cultural context of preparedness, and we'll hear about resources. And now I am ready to turn over the microphone to Dr. Charles Cefalu.
Can everybody hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Dr. Cefalu has been an academic clinician educator during his 32-year career, including academic appointments at LSU, Tulane, Bowman Gray Wake Forest, and Georgetown University Schools of Medicine. He is currently professor and chief of the Section of Geriatric Medicine at LSU School of Medicine and program director for the Geriatric Medicine Fellowship. He is also the author of numerous regional, national, and international publications relative to geriatric medicine and has spoken at various local, regional, and national geriatric conferences. He is a Hartford Geriatric Scholar and is board certified in family medicine and geriatrics. He was also elected in 2010 to serve a 3-year term on the board of directors of the American Geriatric Society. He is also currently serves as chair of the Clinical Practice Committee of the American Medical Directors Association. Also, Charles will be having a Q&A at the end of his presentation. Please feel free to write any questions you have into the chat pod on the left. And now, Charles, thank you.
Thank you all very much. It is a pleasure to be here today and to share with you some lessons learned from Katrina and Gustav. We're going to talk basically today about disaster preparedness. First, let's say that during Katrina, there were 300 nursing homes in Louisiana. 120 in the New Orleans metro area were affected by mandatory evacuation. 40 nursing home patients died in the New Orleans metro area nursing homes. As a result, state law now mandates dual responsibility of specific nursing home and oversight by DHH relative to evacuation procedures. The next slide basically shows the non-operating senior care facilities as of 1/06, which is roughly 4 months after Katrina, basically showing the degree of devastation in the New Orleans area nursing homes after Katrina. Some of these have still yet opened. The next slide basically describes how our recommendations came to pass. The Louisiana Healthcare Review Organization is the Medicare Quality Improvement Initiative for nursing homes and hospitals in the state of Louisiana. We had weekly teleconferences with physicians, nurses, other staff, administrators, several months after Katrina to provide assistance and communications and to advise displaced physicians, clinics, hospitals, patients, and families relative to what to do after the disaster. The Long-Term Care Committee workforce also met monthly to provide assistance and advice to nursing homes. So these workforce recommendations, basically involve hurricane preparedness, that is advanced planning. Hurricane plans basically then should be reviewed every year as part of these recommendations. You should contract with 2 evacuation sites, one east and one west, or in your case, one in the north and one in the south region. It's important then, as a recommendation, to review your bus service contract, as many bus companies were overcontracted, as we found out later. It's important to stock extra medications during the hurricane season to keep these supplies separate, and to choose a pharmacy that keeps backup electronic medical records as well as hurricane supplies that are basically separate from regular supplies. Workforce recommendations relative to evacuation involved leaving as early as possible when you knew from the weather service that that hurricane was heading in your direction. Making up emergency kits for each bus, designating a person to be the first on arrival to the other nursing home to direct activities at the evacuation site, to notify families regarding the evacuation that was in process, to staff buses by acuity level of residents, in other words, low, medium, and high acuity. This makes for better staffing and better transport for patients with similar clinical and cognitive decisions. It's also important to place roommates on the bus together because these residents would be familiar with these residents and less likely to become agitated. To triage residents by ambulatory or functional status, as was just said, and to use diapers instead of catheters to make sure all residents toilet prior to getting on the bus. In addition, the identification of residents should occur with the use of armbands, making pictures of the residents relative to supplies and equipment, each bus to have separate supplies, ordering extra medications, having ice and water in each bus. Most important for August, when summer is at its worst in the New Orleans metro area, where are there no air-conditioned buses, and not enough if you have any. Sending launch equipment ahead of the bus and making sure oxygen tanks are indeed secure on the bus. Now, relative to weathering the hurricane, using some type of radio system, adequate communications, since many hospitals or facilities could not communicate with each other, and designating a local hospital en route to serve as a common communications point was also one of our most important recommendations from this disaster. Relative to security, after the break-in, these things are going to occur. Whether you're at the facility you're evacuating from or the facility you're evacuating to. Relative to power, making sure a large enough generator is secured for after the hurricane, especially after it relates to powering the ice maker. Relative to identification, again, armbands for residents and pictures of residents. Making sure that when that patient is evacuated, there is at least sufficient records to accompany that resident, including the most recent orders, most recent progress note, most recent labs, and the face sheet, especially to identify family members. It's important to have supplies such as chainsaws, tarps, and plenty of IV fluids if you're weathering the hurricane. Trees go down. They impair the pathway. That must be relieved. Pharmacy supplies. There must be some backup system of pharmacy supplies as well as computer records stored in a different geographical area. And that's where the computer backup system comes in most handily. Relative to transportation, for employees coming to work after the hurricane, there must be an emergency transport system in place, in many cases, remedied by the police and the firemen. And then there's the issue of serving as an evacuation shelter. A short video clip will be shown shortly. While waiting, please type in your questions to me on the dialog box to the left of your screen. Send to everyone, and thank you for listening.
At the bottom of the screen. And thank you to the Big Uneasy. And back to you, Charles.
Okay. Getting back to our workforce recommendations, if you're serving as an evacuation shelter, your resident population may double overnight. Therefore, you should triage residents upon arrival. Place residents in rooms and areas of the nursing home according to their needs. Example, tube feeding versus bed-bound patients, which allows rooms to be stocked quickly. Arriving facility should bring identification of residents and medicine sheets. And partner with schools of nursing to use as a resource to man shelters or help out at nursing homes. This was a tremendous benefit during Hurricane Katrina. Relative to disaster-specific position descriptions, remember, the administrator, director of nursing, risk manager, maintenance, housekeeping, dietary, social services, activities, medical directors, even other residents and other employees, all are very important and each have their disaster-specific position description that is very important to carry out this vital function of evacuation or sheltering in place. The role of the medical director, very important. Disaster preparedness planning is most important for that person, involving the decision to evacuate, to shelter in place, the events that occur in between the disaster, after the event, and to look back and to see if things could be done better from a quality insurance standpoint, Keys to clinical management, regardless of a disaster results in planned or unplanned response, including evacuation from the entire facility or part of the facility, the clinical care and critical services always must go on. Identify conditions that may worsen stress. Confusion, the dementia patient, the chronic pain patient, the anxiety patient. These are all issues that are going to become at a heightened level during a disaster. The distractions, the confusion, the environmental noise, especially dementia patients. The diabetics can be very brittle. Make sure they're managed appropriately. Remember that constipation occurs, especially during the bus transport or sheltering in, because these patients may not get enough fluids, so hydration is key. For the hospice or declared terminally ill patient, they must be cared for properly too. And then how will you manage infection control as a whole and for residents with infections? Those are all issues that must be kept in mind before, during, and after the disaster. Diabetic conditions, we've mentioned. The use of oral hypoglycemics, insulin, oral agents for supplementation, all of these supplies must all be considered when you're transporting a patient and monitoring that diabetic as well to the extent possible. More lessons learned? Remember that there are state-to-state relationships across state lines. Identify what members have facilities in other states. There may be corporate membership. Facilities state-to-state share supplies, services, and human resources. Affiliate with your state board of nursing and your schools of nursing for extra manpower. They serve as excellent resources. Advocate for license and reciprocity agreements for staffing, especially facilities that are part of corporations between line, across state lines, excuse me. Keep abreast of board openings and opportunities for long-term care representation. Act as a center repository for provider ideas and offers, housing, employment for displaced workers. Any ideas that come forth from any employee, any staff, any patient must be considered at the quality improvement meeting. And now we'll have a question and answer period.
Thank you, Dr. Cefalu. We will now have a Q&A session. Please write your questions into the chat pod on the left, and Dr. Cefalu will do his best to answer them.
Is there a question from Arleen Johnson? It appears, what sort of emergency medication procedures are in place for those who do not have prescriptions with them, who are unaware of what they take? Of course, the issue here is having a copy of the most recent orders. And there should be emergency medications in the emergency cart, which should be transported with the patient on the bus. So there's your source of emergency medications right there. Other sources of emergency medications can be obtained from the nearest pharmacy on an emergency basis. Are there any other questions?
Marita Grusten has a question. She says, thank you for such a comprehensive presentation. My question is, how are these workforce recommendations monitored? I imagine it is very difficult for any facility to implement these.
Well, that's a very good question. How are they monitored? Well, these are monitored at the quality improvement meeting monthly, where there is a line item where emergency preparedness should be discussed, certainly, with areas for improvement. And then before each hurricane season, several months before, at the care plan meeting, typically what happens is the MDS or care plan coordinator will ask the family, number one, would you want to pick up your relative or do you want them to go on the bus? And if they would like them to go on the bus, they inquire about 3 days worth of clothing and also ask about any other issues that need to be addressed with the family. And thank you for that question. There's a question. Do you know what percentage of nursing home residents were cared for by family members during Katrina? Any feedback on how this worked? I don't have actual percentages. I think the overwhelming majority of residents, I'd say about 95%, were evacuated by public transportation and not by the family. Another question is, how was the transfer of patients from facilities that could not open till their ultimate assignment? Let's see if I understand that question. I think the issue here is, if there was a facility that was receiving residents that could not, then there was an alternate facility in place, and that works very well for the corporate relationship, where typically a facility will transfer to a sister facility within the corporation. Another question is, how did you meet the nutrition needs? Did you need to partner, let's see, with outside food providers? Very good question. Yeah, nutrition is always an issue, and it did occur that even though nutritional supplement and tube feeding supplies and food was provided prior to transfer, during transfer in the form of snacks and at the accepting facility, there was a need on a regular basis, and I say it was very common, to go to the nearest grocery store and get any additional food supplies, because you're usually looking at a lag time where the dietary department can provide food for that double population. So that was a common scenario. Any other questions? I'd like to also add that the question about a backup facility is very important. What we're saying here is you not only have a receiving facility on paper, but an alternate facility in a separate, distinct other direction. Any more questions? Okay, here's a question What do you recommend if we have a no-notice disaster and all forms of communication are down? What do you recommend we do? Can we get outside help? We're basically talking about disasters where you really have little no prep time. You may be talking about a nuclear issue, an earthquake issue. That's a very good question. In a situation like that, where cell phone towers are likely to be down, your best bet is to have a system in place where you have a backup communications satellite system where you can communicate by satellite rather than cell phones. Are there any other questions?
I believe here's one. Or I believe one is about to come in.
Okay, here's a question. In addressing Bertha's question, maybe have someone in the facility being trained in using ham radios. Yes, excellent idea. And ham radios did come in very handy during Katrina because the cell phone system was out of order. Other questions?
Okay, I think if there's no more questions, we can move on. Thank you, Charles. That was very, very informative. Our next presenter is Arleen Johnson. Arleen Johnson, PhD, is the director of the Ohio Valley Appalachia Regional Geriatric Education Center, a consortium of the Universities of Kentucky, Louisville, Cincinnati, and East Tennessee State University, which is administratively based at the University of Kentucky College of Public Health in Lexington. Since 1970, she has been a researcher, educator, and direct service worker in the field of aging. She helped to develop the National Agenda for Emergency Preparedness for Aging and actively participates on the National GEC Collaborative. Her work in emergency preparedness is focused on rural aging services and long-term care providers. She is co-developer of the Kentucky All Hazards Long-Term Care Planning and Resource Manual that was designated as a 2010 National Best Practice by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services Office of the Assistant Secretary for Preparedness and Response. Welcome, Arleen.
Chris, thank you very much. I am hearing feedback. So if I need to turn my speaker down, someone let me know that. Those of you who are with us hear me okay? I know there's been some trouble with the audio.
I hear you fine.
All right, good. Janet says I'm doing fine. Bertha can hear me great. Looks like we're on the move here. Well, I'm so glad you could be with us today, and I want to very much encourage you, if you have the opportunity, to take a look at the Big Uneasy DVD that we had a little portion of during Dr. Cefalu's presentation. It's a marvelous resource for training, and it has a lot of good information about facility collaboration and leadership within facilities and across long-term care facilities. So it's really an excellent resource for you. At the end of our session, we're going to be hopefully able to identify some of the rule issues for emergency preparedness for aging, be able to describe why long-term care residents are at high risk during emergencies, and also talk about some of the primary features of an all-hazards long-term care plan. You see on your screen some of our inspiration for our long-term care planning here in Kentucky. We've recently had chemical spills, ice storms, floods, both in our urban areas and our rural areas, and hurricane force winds, even in Kentucky, that resulted from Gustav and Ike, and also had 1,000 evacuees from Gustav to a shelter in Louisville. Today, just before our webinar began, we actually had tornado warnings here in Lexington, and we were all told to go to the basement and hide. So I'm delighted that that threat has passed and that we're here to actually participate in the webinar. The issues related to disaster preparedness in rural areas are a little different than those that were described by Dr. Cefalu. As you look at your slide, the geographic isolation is a very important characteristic of rural areas. And there are great distances oftentimes between our towns in rural areas and also between farms and residences. It's hard to notify persons of emergencies when you can't get to them, when the only road in or out is closed out by a mudslide or creek-wise rise or ice and snow. Socioeconomic levels are also lower in rural areas. More than half of our rural seniors have family incomes below 200% of the poverty level, compared to only 40% of urban seniors. And this might be one of the reasons that our rural elders have less available income to pull together emergency kits and emergency supplies and equipment that they might need. Another particular area for rural areas is farm animals and farmland. And it is very difficult for farmers to be willing to leave their farms when they know that there could be a huge loss of income and also that they need someone there to take care of those animals and to take care of that land. Public transportation is virtually lacking in our rural areas, and therefore access to services is greatly compromised. We have fewer telephones. That, of course, affects our communication capabilities. And then personal vehicles are also fewer for those living in rural areas. Telephones also are fewer, so communication, again, is made difficult. The educational status is lower in rural areas in general, and that may also cause problems with communication. Our technological infrastructure is lags a bit behind the urban areas, so that may mean less computer access or internet access or cell phone coverage in those rural areas. We also have the availability and access to services issues. There are fewer health and social services and behavioral health services that are available. Retention, recruitment, and pay are more issues in rural areas. It's difficult to get professionals to move to rural areas, and oftentimes there's great turnover. We have about 100% plus turnover in our long-term care facilities on an annual basis. Limited access can be a problem due to the distances between services and persons who need them, also roads and weather and transportation issues because of lack of transportation. Rural areas also traditionally have higher chronic disease, and this means for special problems in shelters and for long-term care facilities when they're sheltering in place. And also, persons who live in rural areas are very independent. They're very self-reliant. And so when the call comes to evacuate, they may have other ideas about whether or not that should happen. They may feel perfectly capable of managing on their own where they are, and that may cause some issues. The picture you see on your screen is a very chilling picture of elders at high risk from Katrina, and this is from the evacuation during one of those hurricanes. And we know that our older persons are at much higher risk than other persons in all types of emergencies, not just hurricanes. About 70% are 75 years of age or older. There are cognitive impairments, 13% severe, about 68 to 69% have cognitive impairments in long-term care. This poses a huge problem when you're talking about evacuation or sheltering large numbers in place. Huge issues with persons eloping, leaving those facilities, wandering off, and not being able to keep up with them, and trying to find one-on-one care during the while those persons are in a shelter. Many of our long-term care residents take up to 11 daily medications, and 80% of them have at least one chronic condition. They need help with activities of daily living, 83% with at least one, 60% with five or more. And look at the next item. 50% need help with four out of five issues related to bed mobility, transferring, dressing, eating, toileting. Huge issues for either sheltering in place or being in a community shelter. And 50% incontinence, bladder and bowel, 38% severe. You know what kind of problems that can bring in a disaster situation. 3% have feed tubes. There's a greater chance of pneumonia, 40 to 150%. Higher risk of infections, reduced immune system, reduced response to antibiotics. Those are three really crucial issues for older persons. Dialysis, age 75 plus, is the fastest growing group. And of course, that's the group that you find most often in long-term care. And then you have the issues with oxygen and other medical supplies that are so often needed with our elders who are in long-term care. The assistive devices, wheelchairs, walkers, canes, hearing aids, glasses, all of those can be really difficult to keep up with in evacuation situations. And our residents who are 500 pounds or heavier, our bariatric patients, are extremely difficult to deal with in shelter situations, need special equipment, special transport, and special consideration. So when you're talking about a long-term care plan, there are a number of features that need to be included in those. You need a hazard vulnerability analysis, and that's one of the most important things I want to share with you today. We're going to take just a minute to talk about that. Community planning, memos of understanding, a great communication plan, direct care procedures for all types of hazards, shelter in place and evacuation plans, continuity of operation and recovery plans, and training and exercise plans. I'm going to talk briefly about each of those. So when the National Weather Service issues the warning that tells you to run, you need to know where to go and how to get there. And that's what the hazard vulnerability analysis is about. If any of you had an opportunity to download that handout from the handouts that were sent out to you yesterday for the webinar, you'll want to pull that out and have a look at that now. If you didn't have a chance to look at it, it's a really good tool, and I hope that you'll be able to go back into those handouts and pull that down and take a look at it. It enables long-term care and other agencies and the community or anyone else who wants to use it to look at what the closeness of the hazard is and the level of potential for the hazard. And you need to look both at the usual natural kinds of threats. The last three disasters that you faced in the last year will turn up probably in this list. And then also look at the unique threats that are specific to your particular area. whether your long-term care facility is near a body of water, near railroads, airports, dams, pipelines. All of these pose specific, unique problems that you'll need to be aware of. As you look at the hazard vulnerability analysis, you're going to look at the probability of a particular emergency happening to you and to your facility. You need to know what the risk is, what the past history is, how many times have you had tornadoes in your areas or floods or ice storms. You need to look at the vendor statistics. The last emergency that you had, how well did your suppliers and equipment organizations provide you with the materials that you needed? You'll need to look at risk, both for life safety and health safety, and also at the disruption of services. You want to measure that threat to life and health and disruption, look at the loss of community trust that might happen, the financial impact, and the legal issues that could also come about as a related to the risk that you have in your community. Also look at the preparedness of your facility. What's the state of your current plans and training? What insurance do you have? How likely are you are to actually be reimbursed for most of the costs that will be incurred in an emergency? What's the availability of backup systems for your data and for your community resources? All of these are extremely important issues that you'll want to take an opportunity to use that hazard vulnerability analysis and take a look at. In addition to the hazard analysis, community planning is perhaps the next most important issue that you need to look at in working in your agency or in long-term care. Identifying community partners is extremely important. You need to look at the level of collaboration that you usually have with those partners that you work with, and think about who has a reason to be interested in older persons and in their care. Work with all of those different agencies to discuss the ways that you can partner together. I think one of the best ways to host a meeting at your agency or your long-term care facility, invite the utilities, the fire, the police, the public health agency, emergency management, emergency services, emergency medical, TV, radio, faith organizations, aging organization. Have them come if you have the opportunity, feed them a meal, have them walk through your facility, get a feeling for who your residents are, what kinds of different kinds of issues that they face, what kind of levels of care that they have. We had one of our facilities in Northern Kentucky that hosted a walkthrough from the fire department and posed a scenario of what might happen. And what they learned from that was that the fire department would park in the exact door that the facility had planned to use for their total evacuation. So what that enabled them to do before an actual emergency was to reassess their evacuation plan and change the doors that they would use. You need to share information with one another, create contact lists, have those not only in electronic form but also in written form, because if the internet is down and you're not able to use electronics, you're going to need to have something quick that you can go back to. In Kentucky, and it may be true in other states, we are able to download our facility floor plans to police, fire, emergency medical, and emergency services. If you're able to do that, I highly recommend it, because you'll be able to have them arrive at your door already knowing where the source of your emergency is likely to be. Talk about your roles and responsibilities. Discuss your transportation plans and your shelter plans. You need to remember that most often in a community there's limited transportation and community services, and in rural areas, if you share your plans, you'll probably find you've all planned to use those same resources. Dr. Cefalu mentioned the need for satellite phones and ham radios, and I was glad to see that discussion pop up a few minutes ago. And also, remember to conduct exercises, work with one another, share those with one another. And a good way for doing that is to participate in your healthcare planning coalitions. These are funded nationwide through the Health and Human Services Office of the Assistant Secretary for Planning and Response. You might have heard it called by the acronym ASPR. There's strong focus on collaboration and coalition building, and they provide funds to states that can be used for emergency supplies and equipment. You can use those funds to buy lifts, to provide ham radios, personal protective equipment, cots, all the many things that you might need in an emergency. And it's an excellent way to network with your stakeholders, all of those persons who have an interest, so that you can begin to discuss your plans, your priorities. You can buy facility supplies, but you can also establish regional resources like an ambulance bus that could be used for the whole region. And it's very important also to participate in your sharing your long-term care or agency data so that you know what kinds of beds you have available for surge. And there are programs out there, a web-based emergency operating program called Web EOC, and several other programs, emergency management systems and others that are available for that purpose. Here's just a look at Kentucky and our regional healthcare preparedness planning system, and I encourage you to find out for your own state and region and area where your programs are conducted and participate in those regional meetings. It's extremely important to have memorandums of understanding. Dr. Cefalu talked about that. You need to have not only an alternate care plan and a memorandum of agreement for at least one facility 50 miles away, but probably agreements with many other long-term care facilities. In Kentucky, we run at about 90% occupancy with our nursing homes and other long-term care facilities. Recently, after midnight, it was about a fire broke out. We had 60 residents that had to be evacuated. It took 18 long-term care facilities to find sufficient space to move those 60 residents. So the lesson there was we need to get as many memorandums of understanding in place as possible. And remember that many of us will be using the same vendors, we'll be using the same facilities, the same resources, so be sure to get out-of-region backups whenever you're working on your memorandums of understanding. Let's take a minute to look at a case study. If you had an opportunity to download the handouts, you would have seen this already. And if you haven't, I hope you'll take a minute to look over it afterwards. We were hoping that you would be able to read it and take a minute to think about the different kinds of issues that needed to be part of this communication plan during a disaster. Here's the scenario. It's 3 a.m. I don't know about your state, but in our state, things seem to happen on third shift in the middle of the night. Anyway, you've just experienced a 7.7 magnitude earthquake. Now, if you're not likely to have an earthquake in your state, just think whatever you likely have, an ice storm, a flood, a hurricane, a tornado, whatever it is that you usually have to deal with at 3 in the morning. There could be flooding, your street's blocked with debris, sirens are blaring, there's no power source, you're in the dark, there's no access to landline phones, the cell phones are out, the internet's down. Transportation's blocked by trees, power lines, flooding, damaged streets, and you are there in your facility with residents and staff who may be injured or dead. This is a likely happening, and especially in an earthquake situation. So as you think about that, think about the many communication issues that you would need to be prepared to address. We've talked about risk assessment, emergency plans in place. Hopefully you've got your staff preparation in place. I hope you have some incident command system training. I'm going to talk about that in just a minute to help you kind of get up to a date on what that's about. If you are aware of that training and have it, that's marvelous. You need a communication plan that enables you to reach your staff, your residents, your families, others, your ombudsman, your volunteers, all the other many people that need to be called. In terms of reaching out folks outside the facility, if you have the ability to participate in a One Call Now communication system or an Everbridge system, I can share information with you about those two resources. Those are two that I happen to know about. I'm sure there are others out there as well. But you provide for them beforehand information about your call list from your agency and facility, and they do one call out to everybody so you don't have to enact your own call tree. You need your memorandums of agreement in place. You need a communication program within your own facility, either walkie-talkies or runners or messenger services, some way to be talking with one another. If the internet happens to come back into service, hopefully you have one of those web EOC or other e-systems in place that you can send information out about the status of your facility. You need to have a plan in place for assessing the damage, the structural damage, as well as the damage around your facility. You need to be able to identify the supplies and equipment and the vendors that you have access to for the emergency, and the accessibility of others to actually get to your facility. You need a life safety assessment for your residents, your staff, your volunteers, others who might be in the facility. You need to know if there have been persons injured. If so, what are the severity of those injuries? If persons have been killed in the disaster, you need to be able to identify who those persons are, get that information out, and have a plan in place for a holding site for those individuals until help can arrive. And you need to be able to report the status of your facility and your life safety by the nearest satellite phone, or if you happen to have internet service or phone service, out to your county emergency operations center, to your emergency manager. This is the person and the office that will be able to get whatever resources that you need during this emergency. But how are you going to get the information there, and who's going to take it there? You have to have that in place beforehand. You need shelter in place plans in case it's safer to stay in your facility. You need to be able to communicate that to others. You need an evacuation plan in case you need to go. And not only evacuation out of the facility, but you may be able to evacuate to another level or another area in your facility or to a community shelter. And if you're going to a spontaneous community shelter, you need to think about taking everything that you have. And then you need a plan for actually tracking your residents wherever they're placed. So I hope you came up with a lot of those issues in your own response to this case study. And we just need to remember, you know, anytime there's a disaster, you always hope and pray for the best, but then you prepare for the worst. So you need a manual that provides for you templates for all hazards, everything from bombs to workplace violence. You need to know who's going to quickly be responsible for what, how they're going to do it, and when they're going to do it. Determine who's in charge, what they're supposed to do. What are your procedures for every emergency? Is everybody ready to immediately take action? What tasks need to be done in what situation? Where are the checklists for those tasks that you can quickly check off what's done and what needs to be done? And then where are the job action sheets so that you can help persons quickly know how to do a task if it's not their usual daily job? And the key to having this in place is not only to have the templates, but also to have everybody trained so that they already know well beforehand how to take action and what to do. Dr. Cefalu talked about shelter in place, and this has to be a critical piece of your disaster plan. You need to be sure to remember to notify family and residents and emergency management, your ombudsman, your associations, your licensing and certification agencies. And in rural areas, just remember there are fewer resources, so it's going to take longer and be a bit more difficult to get the resources that you need for sheltering in place. In one of our long-term care facilities during an ice storm, they had the only lights and heat in the community, and so they gave out tickets to the community with two-hour time slots so folks could come and get warm and fed, and then they would leave and the next group would come in. And that actually worked really well. But you need a plan in place for having the community surge into your facility and having long-term care or hospitals come into your facility. You need to think about the bed types and the space that you have available. Have memorandums of agreement, of course, with hospitals and other long-term care facilities. Services to enable the expansion that you might need to make for the community. You need to assess not only the number that you can serve, but how many staff will be needed and if there are special kinds of services that you'll need to be providing. You'll need to look at the capability for taking care of your residents and of perhaps others in the community or families, pets, staff, families, volunteers for a few hours or days. What would that take? That's called conventional capability. And then there's contingency capability. That's if it's a longer disaster lasting several weeks perhaps. What additional space and staff and supplies would you need? If you had approximately 108 square feet per cot and approval by a regulating agency to let you bring in additional beds into your facility, how much space would that take and how many persons could you invite to your facility during that disaster? And then crisis capacity talks about a catastrophic disaster, a no-notice event perhaps, might involve long, long periods of time. And that's when we might have crisis standards of care with reduced or greatly limited levels of care. So you need a plan for all of that as well. And all of this, of course, needs to be discussed with your licensure regulatory agency. Because there are, as we know in the long-term care arena, rules and regulations from the Center for Medicaid and Medicare and Medicaid Services that we simply have to follow. And there are waivers, 1135 waivers that our next speaker is going to talk about. But these also need to be considered in your discussion with licensure and certification. And if sheltering in place is not appropriate, then you indeed may have to evacuate. And Dr. Cefalu did talk about that a bit. Remember, it needs to be an integral part of your plan. And on any day in Kentucky, we have about 2,400 long-term care facility, nursing home facility beds available, and we have about 77,000 at-risk elders. From long-term care, assisted living, personal care, home services, HUD housing, and other elders at risk. It's extremely important to be aware of staffing issues, and in rural areas that might be a special problem because there may be fewer staff to go along. There are costs involved in the sending facility and may be more difficult to bear those costs in the low or socioeconomic areas in rural areas. And then resources. There are fewer long-term care facilities, fewer alternate care sites and community resources that are available. Accessibility is certainly an issue always in the rural areas. And remember, when you're surging to the community, it often takes 3 to 5 times more equipment and longer than you might have expected. In your continuity of operations, it's extremely important to think about having as an integral part of your plan all of the different staffing issues and essential functions, safety, protection of equipment and records, and especially important to minimize the disruption with timekeeping and cash on hand and keeping a photo paper trail for insurance purposes. We recently learned from one of our long-term care facilities that went through a disaster that they recommended setting your time clock with an emergency setting so that it's pre-programmed to document staff overtime. during an emergency, and that was extremely helpful during aftermath of trying to report back to FEMA staffing records and get reimbursement for some of those many expenses. You also might want to staff up using your community emergency response transportation teams, using your medical reserve corps for pre-certified professionals, and also using your Veterans Affairs team. In recovery, Dr. Cefalu did cover this. Remember, it has to be an important part of your plan. I would like to stress the need for psychological first aid for your residents and your staff. In Kentucky, we have a community crisis and recovery board that provides free psychological first aid. You may have that sort of resource available in your community as well. And certainly, I can provide information about that. There also may be fewer services and higher costs to recovery in rural areas that need to be considered. I see here that Patsy is going to have to be leaving us, so I'm going to address her question right now. She says, are academic health centers included in disaster preparedness planning? Absolutely. The University of Louisville, University of Kentucky, and other regional universities are very involved in our regional healthcare planning committees and have been very active in providing training to long-term care and other community providers. She asked, in addition to the need to prepare emergency healthcare personnel, is there a role in the community that health sciences faculty may play? That they're likely during a disaster in a community, they're licensed but not assigned to a particular facility during an emergency. And yes, absolutely. The Medical Reserve Corps is a national program, and those persons who are licensed can apply to the Medical Reserve Corps beforehand and be listed and pre-certified to be of help so that they can be participate in emergencies in your area. Those are excellent questions, and absolutely, it's very important for the academic health science centers and for our health sciences faculty to become involved in those ways. Training and exercises are extremely important, and the National Incident Command System is, which I talked about a little earlier in the presentation, is an excellent way for persons to become certified, to be able to work together and work among their agencies. It brings together multiple agencies and responders so that they can respond to any type of disaster. There are some resources in the handouts for you to help you with your preparedness. We've talked about rural issues, high-risk elders, primary features for a long-term care plan, training, and resources. And just remember that disaster planning requires wisdom and patience. So as you're going about this, keep that in mind. And if I can provide any additional information for you, please be sure to get in touch with me. I don't think we have time for questions right now, but I understand there's time after that, after our sessions. So I'm going to turn the program over now to Betty Shiels, who's going to talk about our national level earthquake exercise.
Thank you, Arleen. Our next presenter is Betty Shiels. Betty Shiels, PhD, is the Institutional Director of the Ohio Valley Appalachia Regional Geriatric Education Center at the University of Louisville Kent School of Social Work. Since 1991, she has been involved in research, training, and consulting in the field of aging. She serves on the board of the National Association of GECs. Her work is focused on emergency preparedness for long-term care providers in Kentucky. She is co-author of the Kentucky All Hazards Long-Term Care Planning and Resource Manual that was designated as a 2010 U.S. Department of Health and Human Services Office of the Assistant Secretary for Preparedness and Response National Best Practice. Thank you, Betty.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Chris.
Welcome to everybody this afternoon. I want to share our experiences with a national level disaster exercise that Kentucky and seven other states went through this May that was the most beneficial and most useful and helpful experience that Kentucky has had, and certainly long-term care has had, since we've been working with the State Department of Public Health in long-term care emergency preparedness for the last few years. As Arleen indicated, the University of Kentucky and the University of Louisville jointly work under contract with the Kentucky Department of Public Health specifically to engage long-term care across the state in their emergency preparedness. By the end of my session, hopefully you'll be able to identify the scope of the national level disaster exercise that occurred, the NLE of 2011. You'll be able to describe issues of special interest for long-term care in a no-notice catastrophic event, such as an earthquake, or it could be the tornado, as in Joplin. Third, to discuss lessons learned from the experience of Kentucky long-term care as participants in the May 2011 National Level Exercise, or NLE. A national level exercise is mandated by Congress every year, and that mandate is given to FEMA under the Department of Homeland Security. Until this year, all national level exercises that have occurred have been through the scope of a bioterrorism event or a chemical disaster event. The 2011 NLE was the first time that an actual event was used in terms of a disaster exercise. An NLE of any type is directed out of the White House and literally involves every cabinet level department under the executive branch and all agencies serving those. The parallel agencies at the regional, state, county, and local levels are also involved in an NLE, as well as private sector participation, such as the utility companies, the hospitals, long-term care facilities, and universities. The national level exercise of 2011 involved the New Madrid earthquake. There was a scenario of an earthquake occurring in the New Madrid seismic zone, an example of which you see on the map to the right in that lower highlighted area. The upper highlighted area is the Wabash seismic zone, and in a way those are sister zones, so if a major event occurs in one, it's likely to trigger the other. The exercise occurred the week of May 16th through the 20th of 2011. In that exercise, eight states that would be the most severely impacted by this scope of earthquake at the New Madrid zone were participants. Tennessee, Kentucky, Indiana, Illinois, Missouri, Arkansas, Alabama, and Mississippi all participated in the planning and the exercise. These eight states represent a population greater than the state of California. And the scenario involved a 7.7 magnitude earthquake at the New Madrid Fault. The U.S. Geological Survey took the actual results from the Great New Madrid Earthquake of 1811 through 1812 and applied those to the same geographic area with the current population estimates or numbers with the current infrastructure and building that was in place. And we were able to take actual information using current geologic information and population estimates and anticipate what this area would look like under a 7.7 magnitude earthquake in 2011. The New Madrid earthquake scenario not only included 8 states, but those 8 states participate in 4 FEMA regions, which is approximately half the FEMA regions in the country. So an enormous impact and planning and participation was involved with FEMA. Under the scenario, approximately 715,000 buildings would be damaged. The epicenter of a New Madrid earthquake would be Memphis, and the estimates suggest that Memphis and St. Louis could disappear, and the far western regions of Kentucky could literally become islands surrounded by water, meaning by lakes caused by dams, as well as the rivers on the western part of the state. Across the 8 states, rescue and response would involve 42,000 personnel on 1,500 teams. It's important to note that FEMA has current memorandums of understanding with 1,500 search and rescue teams from all over the world, who in their memorandums of understanding have designated GIS coordinates where they are assigned in the event of a New Madrid earthquake. And they know that they are to report within 24 hours to that specific GIS coordinate. A major concern in this scenario is the potential for breaks and leaks in interstate natural gas pipelines, especially since the major natural gas pipeline from the Colorado Rockies to the East Coast goes right through the New Madrid zone and right through the center of Kentucky. And if this occurred, not only would Kentucky and the 8 states be out of power, but the whole eastern seaboard could be out of natural gas supply for up to a year. I imagine you're getting a sense of the amount of risk and vulnerability that exists should there be a New Madrid earthquake of this scope. If you look at the estimate for fatalities prepared by FEMA and the Geological Society Services, you see that they're estimating 3,500 fatalities. Let me say that that estimate does not incorporate fatalities of vulnerable persons living in nursing homes, in assisted living, in hospice centers, in personal care homes, or in receiving home health care. And it also does not include isolated, frail seniors living in the community, whether they're living with others or living in isolation. As we look at the initial facility response for a long-term care facility, given the scenario, we see 3 likely responses. For those facilities that would be most severely damaged, and that would include half of the impact zone in Kentucky, or over 2,000 long-term care residents, they would most likely have to evacuate to what's called an ad hoc or spontaneous shelter for up to 4 days with no power, water, communications capability, awaiting evacuation by federal resources that could take at least 4 to 5 days. Those facilities would have to plan to get to their destination, and that destination would be the closest location where there was a roof with 4 walls with no infrastructure other than that. For facilities that experience moderate damage, the facility would likely have to evacuate to long-term care facilities outside of the area. Those facilities would be in regions, the damaged ones would be in regions where they're not surrounded by water. They have access out of the region, although all bridges would be damaged and all overpasses would be damaged. So evacuation would be done by air, whether it was helicopter or C-150s. And ultimately, as the roads were rebuilt specifically to those areas, they could be evacuated outside using roads. And they would be evacuated for up to 4 weeks while the facilities and the community infrastructures are rebuilt. Slight damage may occur in about a third of the regions, and those facilities would face scenarios such as Arleen suggested, where they would have to shelter in place because they wouldn't have any access or egress, as that would be blocked by trees or down power lines. Again, the roads would all be broken, the bridges would be broken, as well as overpasses. So resources may not be able to get to them until the infrastructure is repaired. Those facilities would shelter in place under what's the equivalent of a tornado or an ice storm condition, where they may have emergency generator power, but they wouldn't have any communications capability. They would have clean water, and at the same time, fuel supplies would become very limited, as fuel supplies in the impact regions would be dedicated to the most severely impacted area, which would be in Tennessee and Missouri. Sheltering in place conditions for long-term care could last up to 2 weeks until the infrastructure, the roads were repaired, the barriers caused by damage would be taken care of, and intermittent communications capability would be available. If you consider this case study, which builds on Arleen's case study, we're looking at a no-notice catastrophic event. Our scenario again is a 7.7 magnitude earthquake hitting your region. Your long-term care facility is located on a sinkhole and has sustained damage from flooding due to liquefaction. The long-term care facility cannot sustain operations due to moderate damage and risk of aftershocks. Your facility must evacuate to multiple long-term care facilities outside of the region for up to 4 weeks. The county emergency manager is managing transportation out of the facility. Question to consider: what issues would you want to consider for month-long placement across multiple long-term care facilities outside of your region? Long-term care, our effort with our universities, as well as all of our partners at the state level, spent a year in planning for involvement and implementation of the NLE exercise. Outcomes specifically for long-term care from participating in it include Kentucky now including long-term care in their state emergency operations planning procedures and manual. Up till planning for the exercise, we found that long-term care was not even mentioned in the Kentucky State Emergency Operations Plan. Another outcome was that the Department of Public Health Emergency Operations Center has now included specific desks, computer space, and partnerships with our university effort, as well as the state long-term care associations and the Ombudsman Office and the OIG, which is our licensing entity for the state of Kentucky. And thirdly, and very significantly, long-term care has been added to the Kentucky Division of Emergency Management critical infrastructure list for priority response at the same level as hospitals and county emergency operations centers, meaning if Kentucky Division of Emergency Management does not hear about the status of a long-term care facility in an impact zone, a National Guard's person or another emergency management person would be at their door checking the facility out for safety, and if they're not in the facility, locating where the facility and the residents have gone for shelter and being ready to initiate immediate response. Key collaborations for long-term care that have come out of this planning experience and the national level exercise include the state associations, the long-term care state associations, the Department of Public Health at the state level, the hospital preparedness program, obviously the Kentucky Division of Emergency Management, county emergency managers, the state and federal departments of Veterans Affairs, as they operate significant long-term care facilities in the state and also are responsible for 35,000 veterans who are over 65 and could be eligible for long-term care in the impact zone. Kentucky Hospital Association is a significant partner, Kentucky Office of Inspector General, Kentucky Long-Term Care Ombudsman Program, and a new partner who may be one of the most important, and that is the Kentucky Emergency Support Function Number 8, which is under FEMA, and it's the specific emergency support function for response for hospitals and healthcare facilities. And let me just share an experience that occurred last night. I'm in the Louisville area, Arlene's in the Lexington area. And last night, for 3.5 hours, we had a wave of 4 significant storms that came through the area with multiple tornadoes touching down in each storm. A long-term care facility in the region was a direct hit of a tornado last night, and the roof was taken off the facility, and an outside shed was damaged, and cars in the parking lot were thrown up in the air, hit telephone poles, and fortunately did not come through the glass windows of the long-term care facility, but could have, right into residents' rooms. Within hours, Arlene and I received emails and are included in first response with the State Long-Term Care Association, the Department of Public Health, Kentucky Hospital Association, emergency management at the state level and at the county level, as well as the Inspector General and the Ombudsman. And back to Patty's quick question, can university personnel be involved? There are significant opportunities at the state level and at the county and local levels. I would recommend that people contact your state departments of public health who administer the hospital preparedness funds. Some states like to give money directly to the hospitals, and long-term care is not included in that planning effort. So you want to check with how each individual state operates in order to identify what the opportunities are. Outcomes for long-term care in terms of surge response, that was a major focus of the efforts with the earthquake exercise. One of the things we found was that up until the earthquake exercise, long-term care in Kentucky was unable to respond to surge needs. So they would not be able to receive evacuees, such as Dr. Cefalu or Arlene talked about, from other facilities that experienced damage, or the long-term care facility from last night, to receiving sites if those sites exceeded their licensed beds. If they did, they would be cited and they could receive fines. During the national level exercise planning activities, dialogue was created and partnerships formed with the Kentucky Licensing Authority. And as a result, during the major flooding on the Mississippi River and the Ohio River, a long-term care facility across the river in Missouri from western Kentucky had to evacuate because they were under immediate flood risk. And the OIG supported that evacuation across the bridge to a receiving facility in western Kentucky, where indeed they exceeded licensed beds but were able to accept surge so that the public health and long-term care health care needs were met for both the Missouri facility, not putting any barriers on the receiving facility. These were direct outcomes of the collaborations that took place during the year of planning for the NLE. Lessons learned during the NLE as it relates to state and federal resources. Number one, you want to know your state's emergency operations plan, and you want to know if long-term care is included in that plan. You also want to know your local, state, and federal systems involved in a response and what their roles are, be it at the county emergency management level, the state emergency management level, that state ESF8 coordinator for hospitals and healthcare, who is probably located at your State Department of Public Health, as well as the role of the U.S. Public Health Service, which is a national team, which would come in after the fourth or fifth day. It's a federal resource that would take over and assist with shelter operations in a special medical needs shelter, whether it be for hospital patients or for long-term care residents and evacuees. The DHHS 1135 waiver is very important for surge planning. Under that waiver issued by the Department of Health and Human Services, there's allowance or a waiving of select regulatory guidelines that allow hospitals and healthcare organizations to respond to community health needs during a disaster. An 1135 waiver allows for expanded bed use beyond CMS license numbers. It allows for accelerated reimbursement following the event, and it also assists in establishing some guidance for altered standards of care during a surge situation. In order to have an 1135 waiver issued, a request must be made primarily at the state level of the Department of Health and Human Services to the Secretary of DHHS. There also has to be a presidential emergency declaration in place for that waiver to be signed, as well as a public health emergency declaration. One of the things we found during NLE planning was that it's not easy to have a public health emergency declared. So not only do you need a presidential emergency declaration, check with your public health unit, especially the preparedness branch and epidemiology branch, to find out what their planning is and their protocols. On the positive side, an 1135 waiver can be issued retrospective to the event. In usual circumstances, the request is made, the waiver is issued, and the secretary allows that waiver to be in force from the first day of the event to the last day of the event. And I've included a website at HHS that gives you more guidance on the specifics of an 1135 waiver. So lessons learned at the state and federal level include becoming familiar with an 1135 waiver, establish agreements in advance with other long-term care facilities, state hospital associations, State Department of Public Health regarding what's going to trigger a request for the state to request an 1135 waiver. Start your evacuation and surge planning now. It can't start soon enough, especially in a no-notice event, because you don't have time to evacuate prior to the event. You have to go when the event hits. And in order to be adequately prepared, you want to exercise. Another item we found was that hospitals are as uninformed about 1135 waivers, about surge guidelines, surge protocols, as long-term care. And a number of hospitals planned on simply discharging their patients to long-term care under a surge situation, expecting the long-term care facility to provide the staffing, the supplies, and all of the needs of that evacuee from a hospital. In fact, DHHS has guidelines for what hospitals need to consider in order to surge, and it behooves long-term care to know what those are, as well as the hospitals. Another lesson learned was the value of working with your state alternate care site and special medical needs shelter planning group. Long-term care needs to be at that table so that long-term care evacuees don't have to go into a general community shelter setting. In Kentucky, the decision was made that long-term care evacuees would go directly to a special medical needs shelter. And planning is underway to supply that, to have supplies in place, not waiting for them to come after an event happens, and to have the partners around the table know and understand everybody's needs. Also know the local, state, and federal systems involved in disaster response, and I've already mentioned some of those. further lessons learned and for facility evacuees. Dr. Cefalu talked about evacuee records. Arleen touched on that. One of the most significant bottlenecks that can occur is if evacuee identification does not include a current photo. In order for an evacuee to receive medical care in a shelter, there must be two matching identifications, one being a picture ID. If that picture was taken prior to the long-term care resident appearing at the same state as they are when they come into the shelter, meaning if that picture is 3 or 5 or 10 years old, that person may not look like the person who comes into the shelter. And if the photo doesn't match the person who's evacuating into the shelter, that person may not be eligible for a medical care under liability issues. You want to develop a coterie of volunteers and family members, whether it's groups of families that simply are in the shelter with other families, other family members, or volunteers who will arrive at the shelter to assist in one-on-one attention for the cognitively impaired. If you consider how many long-term care residents are cognitively impaired, and you bring in 60% of a long-term care population that has cognitive impairment into an open shelter, where you have open doors, where the persons are not receiving one-on-one attention, not only will you have more golden alerts for patients eloping out of the shelter, but you will also have chaos that one can't even fathom in terms of shelter management. I've also noted some tips on what to have handy and take to the facility in order to entertain long-term care evacuees as well as cognitively impaired. One of the key lessons learned during the exercise is we talk about having three days supply of medications, of food, of water for a sheltering in place situation, where in fact the stress level increases during that 3 days, that actually 5 days worth of food is needed, 5 days worth of water is needed, because the caloric count and the amount of energy used to respond, even in a 3 day setting, requires 5 days worth of supplies. You also need to plan on resident and staff family members coming, including pets, for them to shelter so that staff can stay on the job, or for resident family members who can actually be of great assistance to the whole effort, sheltering effort, not just to their family member, and to have added food, water, and shelter supplies for them. One of the lessons we learned was long-term care facilities think they have sufficient supplies because that's in their policies, but when those plans were actually tested, facilities went to their inventory supplies room and found that the order clerk was trying to save money for the facility and had been using that inventory for daily use, and there was no emergency supply available in the event of a disaster. The benefits from participating in a national level exercise included the learning is in the exercise planning. The actual exercise was very important and very useful. However, the benefit to the state and to long-term care facilities throughout the state was in the planning. We learned and identified more gaps, and we were able to fill those gaps, create new policies at the state level, at the local level, and at the facility level, and the dialogues that were created out of that. If you think about parallel paths, were just impossible under normal circumstances. And we encourage you to participate in a national level exercise if you ever have the opportunity. Planning and improvements will continue well past the exercise, and Kentucky will probably be working on these lessons learned and making improvements in all of our plans for the next 3 to 5 years. And lastly, participating in a national level exercise creates confidence in the capability of the response system. Long-term care now knows that they can count on emergency management, whether it's at the local, the county, the area, or the state level. They know what's in place, they know who to contact, and they know how to be successful in that effort. If any of you would like additional information on any and all of this, or on anything that you don't feel was covered by either Arleen and me, please don't hesitate to contact me or contact Arleen. You have our contact information. Thank you. And now I'd like to introduce Melen McBride.
Before we continue, I'd just like to address an issue that I've come across. A few people have told me they're unable to type into the chat bar on the chat thing on the left, and it's actually the same thing's happening to me as well. So I was going to say, if any of you are having a problem typing in a question, you could try closing out the entire thing and then reopening it again, like re-log into the site and see if that fixes the problem for you. All right. Well. Thank you. Okay, on to Melen.
Okay, thanks, Chris. I am the last speaker for today, and I hope that first, thank you for your stamina. This is the longest webinar we have had for SGEC, and I'm pleased to see that you're still with us. So I'm going to be talking about the cultural context of emergency preparedness. And these are the objectives for my talk. And I would like to be able to talk with you about the different tools that you may be able to use in working with ethnic elders. And the US Department of Health and Human Services asked the RAND Corporation to convene an expert panel. And that happened in February 2007 to develop a clear and widely applicable definition of public health emergency preparedness that can provide common terms for discussion and establish a basis for which to develop a small core of critical standards and measures. And what you see on the slide is a working definition. And the report from RAND is available on its website. And so feel free to go in there and download it. You can get your own personal copy, but they don't give permission to put it up on somebody else's website. And so feel free to visit their site. And in this case, this was prompted by the fact that it's been over 10 years and the federal government is still feels that there's been such a mixed reaction to the different outcomes of different preparedness programs that are out across the nation. And I felt that a public health common definition may be needed in order to be talking the same language. And the aftermath of Katrina, which is in 2005, gives a graphic picture of what happens when communities with unique needs are not part of the preparedness planning and execution. And these are the terms that have been used in the literature. You probably have seen them, and maybe your institutions may have used this as well. And in the situation of Katrina, the poor, racial, and ethnic minorities suffered disproportionately. Many African Americans did not leave early because of communication barriers, and some of them did not know about evacuation orders, or if they did, they did not understand and they couldn't follow it. Latinos and Asian Americans faced similar barriers compounded by issues of language, culture, and their status as undocumented or uninsured residents. So cultural differences and lack of financial resources have largely hindered effective recovery of these communities and even to this date. And there is a Vietnamese community in New Orleans whose community that they work very hard to build. They were Vietnamese refugees. The whole community went into a deep depression, and a Vietnamese priest had to go and help them with some spiritual help as well as to get them back on their feet. The Katrina experience confirmed that effective implementation of public health preparedness programs and policies needs cooperation and compliance from all racial and ethnic populations. And the next two slides just underscores the importance and the urgency to include racial ethnic minority communities, in particular the 65 plus group. This demographic tells us we must get busy. The Asian has the highest increase projected for 2030, as you see there in, it's the Hispanic projected to have the highest increase by 2050, and then we have the Asians following that. The next slide is at SGEC, we have adopted this as our mantra. This is the ethnogeriatric imperative, being that we are going to continue to see an increase in numbers, and that this is really something that needs attention. There is also the issue in the literature on group classification of communities with special needs, as shown in this slide, that influence public policy and allocation of resources. And a literature review was conducted by Andrulis and company to find out the extent that racial ethnic minorities have been considered in public health preparedness, and to identify leading research, promising efforts and resources for training, education, initiative development. Emergency preparedness in this study was defined as readiness to react constructively to natural as well as human-made threats to minimize harm to public health. And there's a link to their report, which is quite a very interesting report. The results, they did go to the literature, they used PubMed, and they also used the website, and I just want to show you, talk about the results on the website, which is really very revealing. You would see that the last line there were only 38 websites that provided information or materials that focused totally on diverse communities, so that's only 12.6% of the existing website. And there's quite a bit of material there, 301 materials that they found. With this result, one would think, therefore, that decision makers are engaged in punting behavior as far as public health emergency preparedness is concerned in regards to ethnic minority and the diverse communities. The general themes that emerged from the study were grouped under five different categories. Some of these are self-explanatory, and I will just talk about a couple of them. Risk communication, if this is a new term for some of the participants, it refers to the science or public health professionals who provide information that allows an individual, a stakeholder, a community to make the best possible decision about their well-being. And it requires an effective communication, requires appropriate selection of messages, messengers, and the methods of delivery to disseminate the information to audiences before an event to after it occurs. And there were also materials in training and education. There was quite a bit of that. Resources were available. And the measurement evaluation focused on the fact that there were indeed some evaluation, but there is lack of widely accepted evidence-based measures and performance indicators for assessing progress and the level of preparedness in racial ethnic communities. And so these were the findings, and there they are also, they have also a report available at the RAND Corporation website. RAND is quite involved in developing materials, and their work is highly respected and widely distributed. And these terms are being used in literature that's coming out of the RAND Corporation. And another slide here, also they have come to also identify the functional areas for special needs group. And I do want to go back to my other slide because I'd like to point out that one missing population group in this classification are the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender group, especially the aging members of this group, because historically they have had experience of isolation and more or less taking care of themselves or each other. And in the case of an emergency preparedness plan, they also need to be included. So these are RAND's classification of functional needs. Now I want to get to another literature. This is the report coming from June Kalis, who says that the classifications or groupings that in a disaster, this is always very inclusive. You are guaranteed that disasters will affect everyone. But the response and recovery are not, and unless we plan for it, then there is a very good chance that there are those who will fall through the cracks, and there are those who won't make it because they were not part of a plan. And this was highlighted in October 2007 when California had 15 wildfires almost going all at the same time. It led to the largest evacuation in California history. Over 2,000 people took refuge in more than 50 shelters, and approximately 500,000 evacuated. During the recovery phase, it was discovered that there were ethnic communities living in the canyons whose existence were not known to emergency responders. The term special needs does not work because it does not provide guidance to operationalize the necessary planning tasks. And a better way to think about the needs of people with disabilities and activity limitations is to use an orientation that considers major functional needs, such as what is listed here, communication, medical, maintaining functional independence, supervision, and transportation. And preparing to accommodate people with functional needs usually translates into emergency response systems being better equipped to serve diverse and sometimes vulnerable populations. You may remember years ago, if you were already around, the discussions about the needs of the disabled people in terms of mobility in public places, and there was this major discussion about the sidewalks and that the curbside was high and wheelchairs couldn't go through. And there was a very long effort of that community to try and make changes on the sidewalk. And it took a while, but now you go in different places in this country and you see sidewalks that are adapted to wheelchair-bound population. So things can be done. And we also went to the community, the Stanford GEC, asked the seniors what are their key complaints about preparedness. And these are some of the listed responses. We also went to the service providers and asked them also what they think are major important issues for ethnic elders. So the blue listings here are responses from ethnic elders, and the black prints responses are from the providers. The language interviews came from the Chinese and Hispanic interviewees, and going to a central place in the community came from American Indian community. Clarifying payment for emergency services was a surprise, because we assumed that, you know, in an emergency, people wouldn't think about this, but they did. And this was coming from the Filipino-American community. Educating the staff came from the Japanese-American community, and consulting ethnic elders came from the African-American community. And so that just gives me us a little idea of what is happening out there in terms of the thoughts of certain ethnic elders in the area that we serve, our service area. Now, as you look at this slide that you have in front of you, you think about the ethnic elders who responded to the SGEC community interview. Imagine that each one of them have three or four conditions that are listed here. And as a primary care provider, your care plan includes helping this elder to make sure he or she has a personal preparedness plan. And when and how would you begin? Kalis emphasized that informing or helping the ethnic community to successfully understand about preparedness, especially those who are language challenged, is very difficult. Furthermore, she said she thinks that when they learn how to trust, how to gain trust from them, when we providers learn how to gain trust from them, that will be the secret to our success. And until we learn how to do that exactly, she doesn't know that we'll find a perfect recipe. And so with the results of the literature review saying that there is limited resources out there for us to use, for those of us who are very interested in research, I would encourage you to continue with that interest and contribute to evidence-based information that's out there, and help with the generation of information, and then also in your practice setting, try and see what are the needs of the ethnic elders that at this time you could already respond to. And here are a list of ethnogeriatric tools that hopefully after I've provided you with some information, you might find them useful in your setting, or you could try and see whether it works for a patient or for the community. And if you do try this, let us know if you need any clarification. And also, when you use it, let us know what the result that you had gotten from it. Now I'm going to try and I'm going to talk about each one of them. And the first one is using a culture guide or a culture bridge. And I think maybe most of you are familiar about this type of person, an individual who usually, typically, may be a trusted member or a community leader. And the trick is, how do you find them? In your setting, some of your employees who might be from that community may be helpful. And this is also where your outreach work may come. And as you go and meet with leaders in the community, that there may be a way that some of the potential culture guides might surface. Another resource is the Collaborating Agency on Responding to Disaster. That's an acronym of CARD. It is based in the community. It's in California, I mean. And this resource began in San Francisco after the Loma Prieta earthquake, and that was in 1989. Immediately after the quake, service agencies received calls from concerned family members asking about their older family member who may be receiving care from the agency. An agency that serves hearing impaired clients from diverse cultures were asked by family members on the whereabouts of seniors who lived in the city. The agency, along with other nonprofits, were unprepared to handle the call. And CARD was formed as a community-based initiative with support from the local government. And the model developed statewide and is now a national resource. And they have a really very interesting website. And they have some tabletop exercises there that you could try, or if you are planning for staff training, that's something that you could use. And they also provide help if you wanted to begin to address the needs of the functional needs of the ethnic community. The other tool is Culturagram, which is an assessment tool developed by Brownwell and Congress. This assessment was initially used in working with ethnic elders in racial ethnic communities, and this can be adapted to assess preparedness for ethnic elders. For example, I would just pick a few. Language spoken at home may give you an insight on what kinds of language material to prepare for the patient or for the client, as well as the family members. And if you were helping the elder in preparing their own personal preparedness pack, and they have limited English capacity, that one of the things that may be included in that personal pack are maybe cards in the language of that person and translated also in English that they can use for communication if they were in a shelter where no one can speak their language. And they can use that card perhaps, you know, to communicate with the shelter staff as well as the volunteers. The other two items that I just want to talk about is the contact with cultural and religious institutions, and also know about the holidays and special events. For your outreach work, this may be two great places to make contact with gatekeepers and potential culture guides. It also is a way to make the agency that you are with visible to them, putting some real human face to the agency that is in their community, and especially if you're noticing that the agency has very low usage from the community, and an outreach would be a very useful thing. Values are very important. Try and understand how the ethnic elder things about power. I mean, the power of establishments or the power of decision makers. And think about the possibility of evacuating a community out of the area. And there is a door-to-door canvassing and instructing people to evacuate. And the public health staff might be wearing a lot of protective garbs. And they then in the home of an ethnic elder, they would knock at the elder's home and may feel that having somebody with this kind of authority is too intimidating and threatening and might be very difficult for them. And in our work with the ethnic elders, when we went and interviewed some of the elders, that they were asked in an emergency what would be the first thing they would do. And some of them said, well, the first thing we would do is wait for our family member to call us and tell us what to do. So therein is a two different approach here. You have somebody standing at the door saying, we've got to evacuate you because this area is unsafe. And then this ethnic elder is saying to herself or perhaps to the staff that they are waiting to hear from their family. And by the way, there are ethnic elders who are still unable to use technology very well. They may have cell phones, but they may not be using the cell phone. And so these are also some of the challenges to helping the ethnic elders in preparing for an emergency and during the emergency, the kinds of reactions that you might get. Another tool is what we call a cohort analysis. In your handout, we have there's three different handouts there that talk about cohort analysis. This is an approach that can help develop insights into the impact of ethnicity on health and mental health needs, and to be aware and understand that certain historical events experienced by a cohort of elders as they move through their life cycle may change their attitudes or their values or their behavior, and this may influence their reactions to the healthcare providers or in the healthcare system. There are charts of eight ethnic groups in your handout, and there are two cohort analysis tables that had been used to teach students in psychology and nursing. One can also use this in assessing assessing ethnic elders in the clinical setting. And in preparation for an assessment, for example, to interview or take a history, a primary care provider could ask herself or himself a question such as, what happened in the past that may have triggered an important change in the older person's beliefs, attitudes, and or lifestyle? And at an appropriate time during the interview, ask the elder if they had had major events in life that changed how they think about healthcare. And this may give some insights. And here is an example of a historical event that has influenced the attitude of a Vietnamese immigrant when she participated, or when this Vietnamese elder participated in a focus group about disaster preparedness. And the question was asked about who would you seek help from? And the response is, I'm kind of afraid to stay in touch with the police. I hear that police officers, they only come to your house for a bad problem. And whenever a police shows up at your house, there is a problem. That's why I'm afraid, just like the police officers in Vietnam. And I think this was in reference to the Vietnam War and the kinds of difficulties that the population experienced in their country. Here's another tool called the Ethnic Elders. It's an acronym, and each of these items listed can be used for the assessment of an ethnic elder who may be a new client or a regular client who needs help with developing a personal preparedness plan. It can also be used to develop educational modules for the elders and for the community, or a guide to develop a curriculum module to teach primary care providers about preparedness needs of the ethnic elders. And certainly for researchers, these areas are very great potential field of study. And here are the elders' mnemonic translated into different items and areas of interest or study. I spoke about the survival kits and having maybe language cards in them. In communication also, if you look at letter D, is differentiate from stress-induced anxiety and language difficulties. Think about an emergency shelter where an ethnic elder who is separated from family may sound agitated or confused when they're speaking. But this may not be anxiety. Rather, it may be having to mentally translate the native language into English while the shelter is in an evacuation mode. And it may take a while for the older person to communicate what they are in mind, but it may look like they're in extreme stress. It may, of course, be stressful, may feel stressed if the elder feels that there is a certain kind of frustration from not being able to express themselves. The third tool is communication. It's a LEARN model acronym. And this communication tool was first developed for family medicine residents at Stanford University to learn more about the patient's explanatory models about their health issues. And we can adapt this to learn more about from the ethnic elders about how they perceive emergency and disasters, either while, before a disaster, after a disaster, and try and understand what their perspectives are. Some cultures think that events like this may be punishment of God. You've heard some of that during the Katrina hurricane. And that when you have these kinds of perspectives, that part of the help that may be given is to try and help the older person to understand the issues at hand and acknowledge the differences between what the provider perceives are the things to be attended to and the things that for the elder might be more important. I think we've also seen that in Katrina, that some of the elders didn't want to leave their homes because they had their pets, and the rescuers were there because they wanted to take the elder out of their home. And so that's a kind of a tension in there. And try and recommend an approach and then negotiate a comfortable arrangement with the elder. I am reminded of a situation of a disabled person who was connected to an oxygen tank and other equipment. and was being evacuated during the recovery period in New Orleans. And this individual was willing to be taken out of the home. However, because there was no other equipment that could come with that person, then the individual requested to be just taken out of the home and left somewhere in a kind of a high ground and to be left there. So rescuers, the responders, respected their wishes and left him in that area where he had chosen and left him some provisions. And we, of course, probably know, could guess what had happened to him afterwards. Another mnemonics is the speak mnemonics. Dr. Kabilars, who developed this, and I think he's in New Jersey right now, is running a clinic there too, a primary care clinic with mostly geriatric patients, recognized the importance of health literacy and developed these mnemonics. And let's think about the fact that there is a lot of literacy that needs to be attended to and addressed in preparedness as well. At the level of the staff, at the level of the clients and the communities, you've heard the presentation today from Charles, Arleen, and Betty, and you have seen a lot of the terminologies. And that is a literacy challenge for all of us to try and straighten out all the different acronyms and all the different agencies. At the level of the ethnic elder, yes, the idea of talking about having a backpack or having a personal pack and having things in there that are important and knowing what those things are for. Those are elements of literacy that can confuse sometimes the issue of who's going to be prepared and who is going to help the elder. Also, if there is the issue of language, this makes it quite difficult, and it takes time. So when you can, and if possible, we are all very much probably under-resourced at the moment because of all our budget cuts. And it takes time to get the trust of the ethnic elder who may be in a client of yours to even begin to think about disaster preparedness and on an assessment and trying to build that trust is a very important thing. And some of the approaches might be related to exploring what their goals are, what they understand about preparedness, how can you educate this person without scaring them, and helping them to identify what resources they might have at home and among their families, and to begin the dialogue about preparedness for the patient as well as for the family. And you probably had picked up from this presentation and in your own experiences out in the field that communication is a critical issue for ethnic minority elders with regards to preparedness. It is not known whether immigrants with limited English proficiency who may be poor and have low levels of education, that they have the information necessary to prepare for and survive a disaster, or whether the social networks, formats, and languages in which they can successfully receive and respond to emergency information are in place. So a study was done to examine several immigrant communities in Southern California by interviewing emergency staff and also emergency service staff and holding focus groups with immigrant groups. And when they were asked how information should be disseminated, the four groups who participated said that the very first resource they would go to is the radio. And so now in the community, be familiar with what are the different radio stations, perhaps, and then if you want to do a public service announcement or public education, that might be one place to go. And a participant from the Chinese group emphasized language and the frequency of delivering the information, plus a consistent, plus being consistent and then being reliable in repeating the information with the same resource. And this particular Chinese participant thought about a newsletter that comes out of City Hall and suggested, they gave a very concrete suggestion on how to communicate to the elders, the community. Another group who were asked about this, providing information to their community, a Vietnamese participant said that there are many different ways that Vietnamese people do things, and this statement of the Vietnamese participant captures the concept that the Stanford Geriatric Education Center incorporates in our curriculum, and that is the heterogeneity between the major groups and also the variability within the groups. And those are very important things. And as this Latino member of the focus group said, that they need to be shown or told what is the right thing to do, because then they may have their own ideas. And that could be true. So that other participants must understand that they can get accurate information and how that information can be accessed would be very important for them to know. And a service provider who was a participant in this focus group also did say that she understands the need for community education. However, the position that was taken here, a wait and see attitude, was expressed in regards to providing leadership to plan and implement a culturally relevant preparedness program. I would encourage you not to wait, to try and do something about it. And locally in your community, it's very important that you know, and at least you have an idea of what needs are out there. One of the probably first things to build a trust with the community, as well as individual members of the community, is to get a reasonably good sense of where they are at in terms of their thoughts regarding preparedness, what they think is going to happen to them in case of an emergency. If there was an earthquake in Southern California, who can they turn to? Find out who are the people that they will go to. And so a very comprehensive needs assessment in terms of preparedness and their perspectives and the issues that they're thinking about would be very useful in helping the community, the ethnic community, to be prepared in terms of an emergency. And we know that Los Angeles and California is due for an earthquake that is probably larger proportions than we have ever experienced. And so, you know, this is something for us to think about. And the last slide that I have is, and it's it's almost end of our webinar. Is the class, maybe some of you have heard about this. Go to the website, because these different standards have been translated into educational modules. And please feel free to go to those courses. And I can see that some people are already signing off, I think. And I guess you've all gone into the websites. And the handouts that you have copies of the three studies that I have referred to, the three reports. And I hope that you will find them useful. And should you have any questions, or if we can help you begin to think about preparedness program for your ethnic elders and their families, please let us know. We need for you to do something in your community on a small scale, and then see what that happens, and take small steps. And thank you very much for your participation and your attention. I guess if there's any questions, are there any? I haven't seen any.
Thank you, Dr. Cefalu, Johnson, Shiels, and McBride. We now do have some time for the presenters to answer your questions. If you have any questions, please use the chat feature located on the left side of your screen. After the Q&A, we would like to ask each of the participants to answer the short evaluation questionnaire. I know we've kind of run over time, so you can go ahead and it's the link to the survey right there. You can go to the questionnaire with that.
Perhaps some people are experiencing the typing issue that you had. Oh, okay. Who should be responsible for their safety, such as timely evacuation and continuity of care before, during, and after a large-scale emergency? Very good question. And this is really where knowing your community comes in. Many of the ethnic communities have organizations, or they may have groups within their churches, or professional organizations and social organizations. To try and understand, to get a good information about who are the leaders and the gatekeepers in that community. And then it's very important to have a dialogue and to begin together to plan for an emergency and get the stakeholders in that community to talk about what would be the best response that the community can have. People who are living at home. There may be a neighborhood watch program in that neighborhood, but perhaps the ethnic communities or the members of that community are not in touch with the neighborhood watch program. And for example, in my community, the local government had actually given the neighborhood watch program the responsibility of taking care of the block by block safety of the neighborhood. And I think look at what the community can come up with. They may have some excellent ideas on how to take care of themselves. And it's just perhaps opening that dialogue and the communication.
Well, and this is Betty.
Thank you for that question. Yes, go ahead,
I'd also
Betty.
Like to respond. The area agencies on aging and programs in each state out of the aging units are a great place to start. If you go to your state websites, probably under your departments of public health and aging activities, And then within each community and county, there are entities that focus on functional needs, activities related to those under aging, as well as those living in isolated situations. In terms of who is responsible for their safety, such as timely evacuation and continuity of care, the most important element to have in place is an individual emergency plan, so that the emergency contacts listed on that plan are part of the development of that individual's plan, and can also be in touch with the response entities and the support agencies. If somebody living in isolation or in a geographically isolated area is who's vulnerable is not connected with a larger entity or an agency or a service provider, it would be very difficult for them to even know who to contact, or for those who are tasked with responding to even know they're out there. Some states also have lists at the state level and at the regional and county levels of persons who are vulnerable, so that their emergency manager and emergency response services, emergency medical services, would have a list to know who is at risk. In Kentucky, that's also handled at the county level through many of the county governments and their agencies. So that would be my best recommendation.
Thank you, Betty. You may also probably have heard about registries for people who may need assistance. And that's a good program. However, that might not be very popular with some members of the ethnic community, for example, especially those who had experience having been taken away forcibly from their homes, such as the Japanese American community and the Aleutians in the Alaska area. And so how to break through that kind of, you know, long-term distrust may be important to address.
Melen, this is Arleen.
Uh-huh.
I would also like to add to the wonderful suggestions that you've had. There may be within the public health agencies in counties or states functional needs. Persons who have responsibility for persons who are at risk with functional needs, and it might be that advocates on behalf of these elders who are in the community might be able to work with those state agencies to also make sure that those persons are represented in the plans.
Great. Great, Alan. Thank you. Oh, okay. So thanks, Arleen, for your comments also. And there's somebody, one of the participants, Ryu Demens, says that he's working on this issue that Alan just raised at the webinar. Great for you, Ryu, and maybe you and Alan can share experiences. Any other question? Here, Ryu is typing.
Nancy, I could quickly respond to what is happening in Kentucky on emergency materials being written in different languages. We have a program called the Kentucky Information and Outreach Network that uses peer groups who work with elders and with whom they're familiar and comfortable to provide information about different kinds of emergencies. And that group works very hard to create lots of materials in different languages that are then presented through persons that are familiar with those elders and that the elders trust. And I know, Melen, you've done a lot of work on this.
I was just looking. Oh, sorry.
What I was going to say for Nancy also, California has lots of materials on websites. There are multiple websites with emergency preparedness materials in different languages, as well as the National or the American Red Cross. They have translated many of their preparedness handouts and materials, I think, in at least 12 languages. And there's no cost to download those and copy those as well.
Right. And our handouts, there's at least one set of material that's been translated in at least two languages, Spanish, I think, and Creole. And in my handouts on the slides, I think there's one slide that gives a URL, a link, that has translated materials in close to maybe 30 to 50 languages in preparedness. So that's one resource also. Another thing is that locally in our service, in the SGEC service area, we have heard from one agency asking for assistance in looking at emergency preparedness for the ethnic community in the area that they serve. So that's very encouraging. Thank you for that question, Nancy. And I also see that Rio has a comment here about the apathy of lots of the seniors, and they don't care about assuming, or they don't, they assume that this disaster won't happen, even though they've already survived several. And sometimes that might be the reason, because they've survived it and say, you know, so what else is new? However, I don't understand what's LOL. I'm sorry.
Also, Rio, the
okay.
What we have found in Kentucky is that it's not just the elders who have the apathy. There are many institutions, organizations. An example I commented on recently was I gave a presentation to 120 operators of HUD-funded low-income housing for seniors and functional needs populations, and only 10 facilities in the room had emergency plans, and only two of them had evacuation plans for the persons living in those apartment buildings, and some of those buildings are 15 stories high. So as we work with the aging community across the board, and in fact, it transcends that. Many entities think that EMS and the police will just come and take care of everything for them, and that they don't need to prepare because they will be rescued. And what we have found is, especially if it's a community level or greater, there are not enough resources for that, and it takes 4 or 5 days to get greater resources in. So part of this is educating people to the effect that we're responsible for our own preparedness to a degree. And again, if we use organizational emergency plans and individual emergency plans and have emergency kits available, that's the best place to start.
I agree. And they said, okay, Rio, great. I guess we are in sync with that one. A great place to start is being personally prepared. You're absolutely right about that, Betty. And perhaps the additional kind of thing is that when, for some reason, you are not personally prepared, then to some extent, you are not contributing to the safety of your neighbors and your neighborhoods. Because then if you need help, then somebody is going to try and help you. And that individual may not be able to help their family or may not be able to carry on the role that they are supposed to do during emergency. It may also be helpful to investigate the CERT program, the Community Emergency Response Training, and encourage as many members of the community to participate in that and see that they get trained. That also helps with eventually getting people to think about preparedness as an important community investment. Thank you, Rio, and have a nice day. Is Rio the last one?
This is Arleen. Nancy, if you're still there, I had a suggestion also in Lexington. Many of our students at the university are from various ethnic backgrounds and from different countries and cultures. And we're working on a program to get them not only to assist with translation to the many different kinds of languages that we need, but also to be willing to agree to take those materials out to their own communities and to distribute them to those persons that they might have contact with from their own ethnic backgrounds. And we've just begun this effort, so I have nothing to report on how successful it is, but I think it's a great idea.
That's terrific, Arleen. I have an intern from UCLA who's volunteering in a nonprofit organization, and one of her assignments is to try and do an informal assessment of the needs, the emergency preparedness functional needs of the community that is served by that agency, and it's in a low-income community agency. I mean, low-income community. Thank you, Nancy, for joining us and for your comments and questions. And thank you for all the other folks who stayed with us through this and continued our discussion.
Okay, is that it? Hello, this is Christopher Mottola at the Stanford GEC. This concludes our presentation today on emergency preparedness and elder care. I'd like to thank the presenters, Dr. Cefalu, Johnson, Shiels, and McBride. If you enjoyed this presentation, please be aware that completion of the survey allows us to continue to get funding. Our next webinar in the series will be on Thursday, July 21st, 12:30 p.m. Pacific Time. It will be on health literacy and health disparities and presented by Drs. Nancy Hikoyeda and Seema Limayi.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Arleen.